either die a hero, or you live long enough to see yourself become the villain. History has proved this point over and over again. Julius Caesar was one of the most beloved, heroic Roman generals of all time. The people that brought him to power were also the people that killed him. He had become their villain. There are parallels in this idea between me and my father's relationship throughout my life. From a young, early age, I fell in love with him as my hero. He was the perfect person that I wanted to become. He showed me all the strengths and best qualities in society. He also introduced me to things that I loved to this day, music and sports. Music, he showed me different kinds, not just one genre, but he showed me everywhere between Frank Sinatra, Lauryn Hill, and other rappers that I still don't know the name of because I wasn't really supposed to be listening to it. My mom didn't really appreciate it. And basketball was the one sport that he taught me. It's my favorite sport to this day. And when I was little, I would put him in the same category as the greats like Michael Jordan, Larry Bird, and Magic Johnson, which, honestly, he's not that good. But for me, as a three-year-old, he was amazing. My entire life, I tried to be a hero, in a sense, like my dad. When I was little, I used to act like a hero. One time, when me, my dad, and my mom were out at one of our friends' lakes, we were kayaking, and we decided to go take a lunch break on one of the rocks that we always used to jump off of. Me being the three-year-old self that I am, I'm adventurous, excited about everything. So we tie up the kayaks to the wall, to the rocks, and we go sit on the rocks to have lunch, take a break. You know, kayaking's a little bit exhausting, especially when there's a wind. And one of the kayaks is not tied up so well, and so it starts to float away. And me being the hero, that three-year-old self that I was, I'm like, have no fear, help is on the way, and I just jump into the water. Luckily, I was wearing a life jacket, but I was still panicking. The water was still freezing around 50 to 60 degrees from the spring snow melt, and I couldn't do anything about it. Luckily, my dad at the time, being the calm hero that he was, got in the kayak, paddled out to get me, pulled me in, grabbed the other kayak, and brought us back. Stories like these exemplify the way that he was my hero in every aspect. He was there to teach me things, and he was there to protect me. Yet this would change, and for some reason, I never knew that this would change, but it did. Life has an uncanny ability of changing things that we think are the most concrete. I thought heroes had to be perfect. I thought my dad was perfect, but that wasn't true. As we grow up, we start to see people that we thought were perfect in a different light. We hear their stories, we hear their tales. And he started to talk to me about his past life and things that he had gone through. As I got older, I wanted to get more rules. I wanted to have more freedoms with rules that my parents made, but the rules they made did not align with what I wanted. They made rules that made me feel like I was a child still, and they didn't have trust in me, and I couldn't go on my own way. This started to have me and my dad start fighting. Around 6th to 7th grade, I thought I knew what was best for me, and he thought he knew what was best for me. But those two things were not the same. And this led to arguments and bickering all the way from 6th to 7th grade to midway through sophomore year. And in high school, it got worse because I got older, I was bigger, and I thought I knew what was more. I thought I knew what was important for me at the time. The worst fight we ever had, it never got physical, by the way, if you guys were wondering. We never hit each other, so there's no way. Came midway through sophomore year of water polo season. I'm around 6'1", 165 pounds, so I'm the same height as him at the time, and I weigh more than him. He's all up in my face, I'm in his face, we're arguing, and I'm just done. I am so angry, there's tears of rage in my eyes, and I just want to get out of the situation. And so I'm trying to go to my room. I try to walk past him, and I, being the petty person that I can be, like, shoulder nudge him as I'm walking by him, and he just doesn't go well. He gets all up in my face this close, and I can't take it at the time because I'm angry as well. And so I shove him into the wall, and that, like, blew it over the top, and he throws me onto my bed and tries to wrestle me to control me and, like, stop me from attacking or fighting him. Yet I, at the time, was also well-sized, and we just fought each other into a stalemate. And the only reason the fight ever succeeded was because my mother threatened to call the cops in the fact of disturbance of the peace. She was not feeling safe in the situation, and I regret my actions at that time. Yet, when my mom left for nursing school sophomore year, left to go to nursing school midway through sophomore year, it forced my dad to take on a new parenting role. My mom would go to school in Sacramento, which was about an hour away from my house, and there she wouldn't be able to be home every night like she had been up until that point. My dad had to change. My dad realized that he needed to change his actions because I was unable to change mine. I was unaware that I also was part of the problem. He started out with small things like helping make my lunches, which my mom had done my entire life. She felt like it was necessary so I could have the nutrition that I needed, and if she didn't do it, I wouldn't eat properly. This was in fact true. Me and my dad split the lunch duty, and he would make the more like meal part, and I do all the snacks. This forced us into contact in the mornings when we were both rested, not tired from work and school, and it helped build a new relationship. Going into summer of senior year, our relationship had shifted because my mom had been at school for that entire time, and we had become closer, and our relationship had turned to more of a typical father-son relationship. I looked up to him, I loved him as my father, but I did not think he was a hero. He was just my dad. He was still on the way here and there. Yet over summer, before senior year, I needed a job. I had been a lifeguard the last summer, and it was way too boring for me, and I didn't want to work it again. And so I was like, who else but my dad, who has worked his entire life to put food on the table for me, to ask? I asked him. He helped me get a job with one of his old contractor buddies instantly. And he got the job for me not based that I could actually do the work, but on the fact that he trusted me to learn what I needed to do. And through this trust, it changed my perspective of my father. My definition of hero went from being perfect and being this great, intangible idea to being something of realism, something where you needed to be there for people, you needed to trust people, you needed to help people. You no longer needed to be perfect, but you needed to be understanding of when people had imperfections. And I felt that when I learned his stories, his imperfections made me feel like his rules were not fair for me because he had broken those rules. He created a scenario where I did not feel like he had a right to tell me what to do based on his earlier actions. But as I grew up, the trust built, and my dad opened up to me more. I realized that he was no longer trying to contain me in a way because he thought it was fun. He was doing it out of love. He did it for me because he wanted what was best for me, and he wanted me not to go down the same path as him. Trust remade him my hero, and in the words of my hero,